Election. It was a handover.
In 1966, they held elections where Abdi Rashid Shemake became president, replacing Osman. Osman. However, now, this did not last long. In 1969, there was an assassination on the president. Shemake was killed, actually, in a kind of mutiny. And a few days later, then General Muhammad Siad Barre came in to restore order and took over the government from 1979, I think May, I don't still remember the month. But Siad Barre started as a great leader. He actually ruled Somalia. It was a very peaceful country. It was developing. Although later in his life, Siad Barre also, like many of the African countries, a few things didn't go right. And then in 1991, a group of Somali clansmen got together and overthrew Siad Barre. And Siad Barre, after resisting from some parts of Somalia, he eventually fled to Nigeria, where he subsequently died. Okay? Like you started alluding to Somalia being a homogeneous society. And that's what it is. Somalia is one ethnic group. Mm-hmm. One. I don't like using this word tribe. You know, tribe is a very derogatory term, which is used by whites to mean primitive people.
Oh.
Yeah.
Interesting.
You know, they have you ever heard of them talking about the German tribe, except in history? They don't. They don't talk of the British tribe.
Yeah.
They don't talk of the Serbs tribe. They call them nations. And when they come to Africa, the Yoruba, who are, I don't know how many times more than many of these people, are called a tribe. It is derogatory, meaning uncouth people, not yet modern,
yes,
and developed. That's why I don't use it. I don't like it. It's an insult, actually. But then we all use it. Even some of our leaders use it. Tribalism is a word we use every day. I don't use it. Instead, I use ethnicity, meaning that attachment to one's ethnic group. Now, the Somalis don't have ethnic groups, but they have something that divides them. And it is called clans.
Interesting.
Aben Kima, Aben Bogo, I don't know what.
Mamba, all that.
And these are the things which divide the Somalis, interestingly. You know, human beings will always get something to divide them if they are not principled.
True.
It could even go to families, can be divided along families. And then, that's one thing about Somalis. They are homogeneous in terms of ethnicity. Religious-wise, almost all Somalis are Muslims. Actually, maybe it is Somalia and Saudi Arabia which have one religion. All these Somalis, you see, don't ask their religion. They are Muslims. So to that extent, there's nothing that would divide them in terms of religion. Obviously, when you belong to the same ethnic group, it means you speak the same language. So, even language, there's no language barrier. At what divides them now?
Clans.
You find Somalia has the longest coastline in Africa. Mm-hmm. It has a coastline of about 3,000. It is 3,333 kilometers of coastline from the Gulf of Aden down to the south. And what is there? The kind of resources you find there. Somalia has got very good, is very ideal for deep sea fishing. Mm-hmm. If you have studied international relations, there's what they call the blue economy, meaning the economy of the sea.
Yeah.
So Somalia is very good for blue economy, in terms of deep sea fishing. They also have some modest sea vessels. They do trade, the Somalis do trade with especially the Middle East and some neighboring African countries, like Kenya, Ethiopia, but the bulk of their trade is with Yemen and some other Middle Eastern countries. Now, apart from fish, what else do they trade? Interestingly, it is charcoal. Now, you know, northern Somalia has very scanty vegetation, semi-arid. And this scanty vegetation is even being destroyed more because they make charcoal. They burn charcoal, which is traded in the Middle East. You know, these countries like Yemen, well, now maybe the Emirates is going to stop using charcoal because they have become advanced. But Yemen is as backward, even more backward than some of our countries. And even Saudi Arabia, I think charcoal goes there. And that's where the bulk of the charcoal
from Somalia goes.
And all along all these routes. So it's one of the greatest trade they have there. There is gold in Somalia, especially in the semi-arid regions, north and northeast. And this gold, and interestingly, don't think much of this is taxed by the Somali government, even in the old days. Mm-hmm. Much of the trade is done illicitly. Mm. It's not licit trade. And that's one of the unique factors in Somalia. Mm. There is also uranium. You may not believe, because uranium, I'm told, are just stones also. Certain kind of stones, which are found in northern Somalia still. And who deals in uranium now? Mainly Iran. Much of the uranium from Somalia goes to Iran. I'm sure you've been hearing the US threatening to attack Iran, that they are making weapon-grade uranium. Mm. Now, some of that uranium is from Somalia.
Okay. Now, you're talking about illicit trade of all these items, fish, uranium, charcoal. Then you're also talking about clans. How does it end up becoming division for the community of Somalia?
Yeah, that's a good question. How does it become, even before we go to division, we may need to look at, for example, the whole phenomenon of piracy. Mm. Why piracy? Well, piracy, there were some groups of people from the Middle East especially, and some European vessels, which would come to encroach on the Somalia fish. They would come, because I have told you Somalia has got deep sea fishing.
Yes.
And so some of these people, because they have more sophisticated ships, they would come and encroach on the fish and take, maybe pay some money to the authorities that are. And then the locals, because that's their livelihood. These Somali people, like I've told you, their countries, survival in Somalia is not as easy. It should not be taken for granted.
Mm.
And so when you come, you want to engage in fish. And some of them were, even Middle East, were trying to take even the charcoal. Mm-hmm. So now the Somali, militiamen, I think, found a solution. That is to attack these ships mm-hmm. and rob them.
The fish that they have taken?
Yes, that's how piracy came about. They would attack you mm-hmm. and then demand ransom from you. And that's why you see...
Demand ransom from the Middle East countries.
From those guys, whether from the West or the Middle East.
Yeah. Mm.
If you have come, you've taken their commodities, they also steal from you. And so they have developed that phenomenon of piracy, which has been there for quite some time. That piracy is old. It's not a new phenomenon, really. But what is new now is after the fall of Siad Barre, Al-Mahdi Muhammad took over as the leader. But then he was not strong enough. When Al-Mahdi Muhammad was a civilian, now you can imagine a civilian coming in after a civil war. He did not have the clout to hold the country together. And so he got resistance from one of the generals, Muhammad Farah Aidid. And so you had war between the two groups. And this war now took on a clan dimension. Farah Aidid is clan against Al-Mahdi's clan.
How many clans do we have in Somalia as a whole?
There are quite many, maybe over 10 at least, the big ones.
Yeah.
But then they also have some sub-clans. But like we said, you know, these clans are really the same people, speak the same language, have same culture, same religion, but divided as clans. There are many. You have the far, there are many, I think. You could say about 20 clans. And so that war got so intense in 1992-93, where the UN had to send peacekeepers, who included Americans. And actually, if the Americans have ever got a rough situation in Africa, it was in Somalia. They were beaten by those Somali militia. Many Americans died until they were forced to withdraw. Unfortunately, you were young, or you were not there, maybe, I don't know. But in 1993, our own president, President Museveni, visited Somalia when buildings were burning. Buildings were
burning,
and President Museveni was moving. First of all, he went to Muhammad. No, no. He first went to Al-Mahdi, had some meeting with him, and even addressed the fighter. And then from there, he moved to Farah Aidid's territory. Of course, within the same city. Like you have observed, Mogadishu was a big city. So, but the city was divided into two hostile camps. And you could not cross from one camp to the other without permission, unless you came to declare war.
Now, before you continue on at a point whereby U.S. comes in to handle these conflicts, Siad Barre had managed to keep the country together.
Yes.
That is before the clans came in.
No, the clans were always there.
They were there, but before they divided on those two lines, we still had the piracy. We still had the illicit trade of all the other things. What magic did he use to keep the country together for that long time, from the 70s?
Yeah, from 1979, from 1969 to 1991. Those are how many years? 22 years.
22 years, yes.
What trick did he use? First of all, Siad Barre was a general. So he was a military man. And he ruled Somalia with an iron hand. In fact, during Siad Barre's time, many of the problems had kind of subsided.
Yes.
Or at least they were underground. But even piracy was greatly curved. Not eliminated altogether, but greatly curved. During Siad Barre's time, there was a function of government which was collecting taxes, customs dues, and all. And then Somalia was dealing with other states. In fact, in 1973, Siad Barre was elected chairman of the OAU, which is the AU.
AU now, yes.
He's the one who handed over to Idi Amin. It was Siad Barre, then followed by Idi Amin. I think you are, I don't know whether you are aware that one time Idi Amin became chairman of Africa.
Of Africa,
of
yes.
The OAU. Mm. So he succeeded Siad Barre. So, and Siad Barre is also the man who tried to bring Uganda and Tanzania together when there was that quarrel between
Nyerere
and Amin.
And Amin, yes.
So Siad Barre, he held a number of meetings, and there was kind of peace talks
that were happening.
Reconciliation, I'm not sure, because later events showed it was not there. But at least there was some kind of
calm.
There was some cessation of verbal hostilities. So Siad Barre was an elder statesman in Africa, and he was respected. Because I think he was also advanced in age. I saw Siad Barre. I saw him here. He was a tall man, not really fat, like Somalis. But he had held the country together.
For that long. Then now I'm going to fast forward you to the 2000s, when, of course, the peacekeepers are going to be sent into Somalia. We see IGAD mission coming in, then taken over by the African mission in Somalia, taking over. And we want to know where these necessary deployments in Somalia. And we are going to talk about that after the break. We are still sitting with retired Major David Rusa, who is talking about sustainability of peace in Somalia. So far, we've looked at the history of where it came from, when they got into the conflict. After the break, we shall continue. Taking you through, I am sitting with retired Major David Rusa, who is talking about, is lasting peace possible in Somalia? Retired Major, I have to be very clear on this. Rusa, we ended on the part whereby I had brought you to where the peace missions have been sent into Somalia. And do you believe, because so many local leaders, especially politicians, have been against sending peace mission groups in Somalia to help keep peace in the area, do you think it was completely necessary?
Okay, and that's what I was waiting for. Is it necessary? One. Two, why send our troops to Somalia?
Because Uganda was the first country to send in the movement.
Yes.
The African mission in Somalia was established in 2007.
Yes. But Agatha, remember I told you, the first foreign head of state to visit Somalia when it was still burning was President Yoweri Museveni in 1993. And it was covered all over, CNN, Ugandan TVs. So that attachment of President Museveni to Somalia, I think, began then. But that aside, why do we feel we should have something to do with Somalia? I'll tell you, as a young boy in my own hometown of Fort Portal, the restaurants that were there were owned by Somalis. Mm-hmm. Yes. Somalis, they used to own restaurants in Fort Portal. In Kampala, Somalis owned restaurants, especially around the taxi park area. So we've had connection with Somalia for a very long time. And by the way, the Somalis as a people are a friendly people. They are not, I wouldn't say they are rude people, and they are not what we call political bigots. Mm-hmm. Neither are they religious bigots. They are just ordinary people with whom you'll get along. Men, I know they love business. Mm-hmm. For business people, well, they will get along with you even regardless of your religion. Now, of course, the problems that have happened in Somalia, especially as we shall see with Al-Shabaab, have made Somalis to be portrayed in bad light.
Sure.
So I wanted to make this clear. In fact, many of the students I have are Somalis, and I get along with them very well.
Students for international relations.
Yeah, nice. They are nice people. I worked in Nairobi for some time, and one of the places I used to visit to for shopping is called Eastleigh. Mm-hmm. And Eastleigh is like the Kisenyo here, an area of Somalis. So Somalis as a people are not what some people may want to portray. They are really, they are ordinary like you and I. And they even have, they are not even violent people by name. Only that they are always suspicious. Because of the hard life they go through, they always have their protection. When you see a Somali driving a trailer, don't dare him. They carry swords or things to protect themselves. Because they have lived in a hard environment, so they have learned to have self-protection. Now, why? The question then is, why should we feel have anything
so attached to
do
to them
with Somalia? Because we don't even share a border with them. And perhaps not sharing a border with Somalia is what makes us a bit more acceptable to Somalia. Because they don't suspect us of trying to take their territory. Unlike Ethiopia and Kenya, they suspect them. But Uganda is not suspected of such intentions. Because how would we take Somali territory? Would we jump over Kenya? Obviously not.
So Uganda does not have any interest
we don't,
in Somalia
we have,
to help.
What interest do we have? It's these interests that I want to enumerate. Even before I go to the bigger ideological interests, let's start with the security interests. We are all aware of Karamojong cattle rustlers and the fact that they use arms. Now, you may wish to know that many of those arms are from Somalia. Many of the arms in Karamoja are from
Somalia. How do they get here?
They get here. And in Somalia, you can even buy guns openly in Mogadishu. They sell guns openly in Mogadishu. So how do the Karamojong get those guns? It is a barter trade. After rustling cattle, they exchange them for guns so that they can rustle more. So I think now you can see the connection. Because if we do not stabilize Somalia, these arms will continue to
coming
find their
into
way
Karamoja.
To Karamoja. That's, I believe that's a very pertinent national interest.
Mm-hmm.
We are beginning from the source that to stabilize Karamoja, first of all, stop the flow of arms,
mm-hmm.
small arms and light weapons.
Mm-hmm.
How do you stop the flow? By ensuring that there is peace in
Somalia.
At source,
yeah,
which is Somalia.
Mm. So that's
that is
second
point,
reason.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
That is point number one. Then, point number two is that Somalia, and like Uganda, is a member of IGAD. I think you know IGAD.
Yes.
Intergovernmental Authority on Development. We are both members of IGAD.
And AU.
Of course, AU, yes.
Yes.
And actually, Somalia is a potential member of the East African community.
True.
Very soon it may join. So all those put us together. And then we belong, we also have similar security interests. Terrorism. Terrorism. I think you are aware that, was it 10th of July? Was it 10th? 10th of July 2010, when
the twin bombing.
Chadondo Rugby Club and the Ethiopian village were bombed by Al-Shabaab militants.
Mm.
And we lost over 90 people. So it is only somebody either who does not understand history or who is unrealistic that will say we have nothing being or dealing with Somalia. We cannot wish Somalia away. That aside, in Kisenyi, I'm sure there are not less than 5,000 Somalis. I'm being very modest, very modest. But I know there could be tens of thousands. In Kisenyi here, down. You have Somalis in Naki Valley, those are refugees. There are Somalis almost in every major urban center in Uganda. And these Somalis have a lot of connections. They even have money transfers, transactions, stretching wherever they are. So if you have to manage these Somalis and ensure they are peaceful, you have to create a peaceful atmosphere in their own country.
However, Major, you see, given we do have reasons as to why we should be helping out in Somalia, but still people here say, especially political leaders, say these are homegrown conflicts. As you said, these are two clans that are against each other.
Not two, there are many.
There are many, but yes, the conflict is drawn across the two. people still say, is the solution for Somalia, is it going to emerge from countries abroad like Uganda, or it should also be a homegrown solution?
It is going to be a homegrown solution. But then, you cannot have a homegrown solution when people are shooting at each other. Sure. You need to bring about a ceasefire or a cessation of hostilities. And then people can begin to talk. And people who have been used to holding arms, you know, we have got what we call peacekeeping, but then there's also peace. There are, in fact, three concepts of peacekeeping, peace enforcement, and peace building.
True.
Now, I advocate that in Somalia, we should have all three. Peace building are those steps that you take to build a society, to have a community coming together, have the civil society, have civic groups, have everyone appreciating the other, talking, doing things that will ensure they alleviate the poverty and suffering of the people. As you talk peace everywhere, it is both talking the walk and walking the talk. Okay? And then peace enforcement is what we are trying to do. If peace cannot be obtained peacefully, then you enforce it using force, using arms. And then three, when there's fighting, of course, what we call peacekeeping is when you separate those who are fighting so that you can then begin to talk. Initially, there used to be peacekeeping as the only option. But then it was realized that this did not go far enough. Because if you separate fighters, and peacekeepers in any case were limited, they could not carry offensive weapons. They had only limited weapons with which to protect themselves. But then in 1995, I think, it was realized that it was not enough to separate people. And then you are held to ransom. When they come to attack you, you don't have sufficient weapons to defend yourself. And so that's when this concept of peace enforcement
comes in.
Yes, that if you cannot have peacefully, then it must be enforced.
Yeah. So now we have seen the African mission in Somalia trying to have peace talks and enforce the peace.
Yeah, that is exactly the approach. That it's a multi-pronged approach. Building peace through different activities. And then
actually, we are seeing the transitional one, building
peacekeeping.
Yes.
You remember one time the Somali government was operating from Nairobi. It was a government in exile governing Somalia. The president would go as a visitor. But today, Hassan Sheikh Mahmoud is living in Mogadishu. He's no longer in exile. He's president, resident president, no longer a non-resident president.
We're talking about Hassan Sheikh Mahmoud. Just recently he said he wanted these peacekeeping missions out of Somalia so that Somalia can start governing itself. After 16 years of the aid that they have been receiving from other countries, from the African mission of Somalia, do you believe they are ready? Are they stable enough now to take on the mantle?
Well, I think it has to be a phased withdrawal. Maybe have some go out, then you study the situation. Obviously, at a certain time, Somalia has got to have its own troops manning their situation. You cannot rely on foreign troops. You cannot be an occupied territory forever. Because the moment you have foreign troops in your country, you are an occupied territory. And you know, these things are funny. A time may come when the Somali armed forces may turn against these African peacekeepers or peace enforcers. So it is better to leave when you are still on good terms.
In fact, even this year, we saw the transition from African mission in Somalia to African transition mission, whereby we are going to, more soldiers were removed, the fighters were removed, and we are having police missions that
yes.
are going in that help
yes.
with the transition. Is
yes.
this part of the phased transition?
Yeah,
you're
it is a
about?
Phased transition until when the Somali armed forces are in position to take over completely. Like you saw it in Iraq. Iraq, I think now the Iraqis have their own troops, although it failed in Afghanistan. In Afghanistan, the force the Americans built failed, and the Talibans returned and overran the country. Well, Somalia is having, because from what I understand, Al-Shabaab has a force of between 7 and 12,000, which is not a small force. It's big. It's big. So the Somali army, which is being trained, needs to be strong enough to resist any attacks by these people when the foreign troops have withdrawn. But of course, the foreign troops have to withdraw. Ethiopia, by and large, has withdrawn. Kenya is also trying to withdraw.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously, Uganda is going to withdraw at some point in time. But then we must not withdraw because it is a fashion. We should withdraw when we are sure that now Somalia has achieved permanent peace. Otherwise, what's the point in withdrawing and then tomorrow you are going back?
You're talking about permanent peace, and as we conclude our conversation, the transition mission is getting out, is expected to get out of Somalia next year, 2024.
Yes.
Do you believe they have achieved that stability that you're talking about?
Oh, very much. Very much. Why?
Draw for us a picture between the Mogadishu or the Somalia that was in 2007 when we had just entered
yes.
and today.
2007, there were regular attacks everywhere, all over the city, and in other parts of Somalia. 2007, the TFG, Transitional Federal Government, could never dare step in, in Mogadishu, except as visitors who would be heavily guarded. Okay? 2007, literally, Mogadishu was a militarized zone. Today, there is a high degree of normalcy almost all over Somalia. Of course, there are attacks. There were attacks. But a lot of countries experience such attacks. India gets attacks from the Kashmir militants. See? China must go to their own groups who disturb them. The United States, well, they have these armed people who go disturbing schools. But of course, the case of Somalia Al-Shabaab is still an organized terrorist group, which is having links with Al-Qaeda. They were not friends with the Islamic State, no. They
even fought.
But Al-Qaeda, is they are affiliates of Al-Qaeda action. And they have links with our own ADF here. Again, that is another reason.
Why we should be there helping
yes,
out in stabilizing.
Because Al-Qaeda has links with ADF.
Mm.
You know, ADF is also an Islamist, not Islamic. I want you always to distinguish between two things.
Islamic
and
Islamist.
Mm. Islamic means belonging to Islam. Mm. But Islamists are those people who misuse Islam as a religion for their own selfish ends. All of us know the Muslims are our brothers and sisters, and we live in peace and harmony. But there are those who want to use Islam for their selfish ends, mm. and those are the people we call Islamists.
Mm.
There are also Christian terrorists. No, there's a time when a Christian man went to a mosque and killed people who were praying. In New Zealand, there was also another man who claimed to be a Christian who went to a mosque and killed worshippers. And of course we know Christianity does not condone anything like violence.
Forgive and forget.
Mm.
Well. And this is what Christianity teaches. Well, it is very sad we have to stop the conversation here. Thank you so much, retired Major David Russo. It is always a pleasure to have to draw from a fountain of knowledge like he has about international relations and Somalia in general. We are going to take a short break, but don't get away. We are going to have Andrew Alinaitwe coming in with the rush talk. Please stay tuned.
Thank you.